जय श्री शिवा स्वामीनारायण। SSGM इंग्लिश मीडियम CBSE स्कूल रन बाय श्री सजानंद गुरुकुल मानकुआ हार्टली वेलकम यू टू ऑल ऑन दिस ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन प्लेटफॉर्म। सो डियर फ्रेंड्स, लास्ट पार्ट वी हैव कवर्ड दैट द लिविंग ऑर्गेनिज्म एंड देयर सराउंडिंग पार्ट वन, एंड टुडे वी विल मूव टू पार्ट टू, दैट इज फ्रॉम अ जर्नी थ्रू डिफरेंट हैबिटेट्स। मीन्स अ जर्नी, जर्नी मीन्स passing through or learn more and more about different habitats. We already discussed what is habitat. Habitat means dwelling place or place where organism survive or where it is living. So some terrestrial habitats also we have discussed. Terrestrial, what is mean by terrestrial? Terrestrial mean on land. Aquatic means on or in water. Okay, so some terrestrial habitats, deserts. We discussed the abiotic factors of a desert and the adaptation in camels to this. What about other animals and plants that are found in deserts? Do they have the same kind of adaptations? Means we have already discussed some characteristics of a camel and their adaptation to this desert environment. So what about other animals and what about other plants also? So we will discuss these parts also here. There are desert animals like rats, snakes, which do not have the long legs that the camel has. To stay away from the intense heat during the day, they stay in burrows deep in the sand. See figure 9.4. These animals come out only during the night when it is cooler. See figure 9.5. Show some typical plants that grow in a desert. How are these adapted to the desert? So friends, they are showing us some pictures of rat and snakes, and compare the different adaptation of camel with the adaptations of rat and snakes. As camel has long feet, so they can keep their body away from the heat. But what about snakes and what about rats? They don't have too much long legs. Then how will they protect themselves from intense heat? So they burrow, deep burrows in the land, and they come out only during the night. During daytime they live in their burrows. Okay, also there are some pictures of plant are shown there. So let us discuss about this also. So activity 3, bring a potted cactus and a leafy plant to the classroom. Tie polythene bags to some parts of the two plants, as was done for activity 4 in chapter 7, where we studied transpiration in plants. Already we have discussed the what is transpiration. Transpiration means losing of water from the leaves, okay, or evaporation of water from the leaves, or removing of excess water from the leaves or other body parts of the plant are known as transpiration. So that we have already discussed in chapter number 7. And here we have told that to bring two potted plants. One is cactus, one is some other type of plant. So activity 4 in chapter 7, where we studied transpiration plants. Leave the potted plants in the sun and observe after few hours. What do you see? Do you notice any difference in the amount of water collected on the two polythene bags? Desert plants lose very little water through transpiration. These leaves in desert plants are either absent, very small, or they are present in the shape of spines. This help in reducing loss of water from the leaves through transpiration. The leaf-like structure you see in cactus is in fact its stem. Photosynthesis in these plants is usually carried out by the stems. The stem is also covered with a thick waxy layer which help to retain water. Most desert plants have roots that go very deep into the soil for absorbing water. So here we also seen some adaptations of cactus plant compared to the other plants that we are living in plains. That first of all, they asked to do one activity similar to chapter number 7, in which we covered the some part or some leaves of a plant and put it in a sun for some time, and after that a few hours we observe some droplets of water in within the polythene bag. Okay, similar activity we have to do here also. Here we take two plants, one is cactus and one is some other kind of plant, and we have to cover some part or leaves of a plant with the polythene bag, and we have to put in a sunlight. After a few hours we have to note how much or who has much water transpirated. Okay, we have already discussed transpiration means who have removed more water. So we will found that the cactus plant remove very less amount of water from their leaves. Okay, first point is this. Second is their leaves are very small. Okay, second they may be absent even, and third they may be in the shape of spines, means jo kaante lagte hain wo. Okay, spines, kaanta. Okay, this shape may be available. Third point, there actually they don't have leaves, but their stem is present there. Also stem is covered with waxy coating, some kind of coating is present outside the stem which retain water, means they does not allow water to evaporate much. Okay, third point and last point, that the roots of some desert plants reach deep to the ground level to absorb water compared to other plants grown in plain or other region. So these are the adaptations of some desert plant which we have compared with the other plants. Okay, second is mountain regions. These habitats are normally very cold and windy. In some areas snowfall may take place in winters. There is a large variety of plants and animals living in mountain regions. Have you seen the kind of trees shown in figure 9.6? So here also we have seen some another type of habitat, that is mountain region habitats. Here generally it is cold and some snowfall may be also occur. The variety of animals is also very large. Okay, and plant is totally different from the plants we have discussed on plains and desert regions. Okay, let us see much more about it. If you live in a mountain region or have visited one, you may have seen a large number of such trees. But have you ever noticed such trees naturally growing in other regions? Okay, they are saying that if you are living in some mountain region or some, if you have visited some hilly area or mountainous region like Shimla, okay, the Himachal Pradesh, so there this type of trees are generally can be observed, but in regions other than this hilly areas you are not able to see such trees or such shape of trees in other regions. Okay, so how are these trees adapted to the conditions prevailing in their habitat? These trees are normally cone shaped and have sloping branches. The leaves of some of these trees are needle like. This helps the rainwater and snow to slide off easily. There could be trees with shape very different from this that are also present on mountains. They may have different kind of adaptations to survive on the mountains. So here they also discuss the shape of mountains plants. First we have seen some normal plants, then desert plants, now it is turn up to mountain plants. Mountain plants, the shape is like cone shape, like ice cream cone, its shape is like inverted cone. It is so because if rain or snowfall occurs, the snow slide off easily. Okay, second thing, its leaf are in the shape of needle, like sui, we have na sui, it is shaped like needle. Okay, so this type of plants generally or normally seen in the mountain regions only, not other than this. So animals living in the mountain region are also adapted to the condition there. They have thick skin or fur to protect them from cold. For example, yaks have long hair to keep them warm. Snow leopard has thick fur on its body. You can also see figure AB of 9.7. Okay, so including feet and toes, this protects its feet from the cold when it walk on the snow. The mountain goat has strong hooves for running up the rocky slopes of the mountain. As we go up in the mountain region, the surroundings change and we see different kind of adaptation at different heights. So here we discussed about some cold region animals like yak, goat and snow leopard. So also their body structure or some shape is different from the normally animals that we have seen in the plain regions. First of all, we see that yak, it has long hair to protect it from cold. Second, we see that snow leopard, okay. So snow leopard means its body has good fur, a high thick layer of fur to protect it from cold. And third, we say that goat, okay, mountains goat, their hooves are very strong. Hooves means their leg structure, the end part of their leg, it is hooves which are very strong to climb up the mountain region to eat plants or some other kind of food. Generally, normal goats, we have seen that they are grazing in the farm area only, but the in mountain regions, these goat climb up to some heighted mountains to for their food. So their hooves are very strong compared to the goats living in the normal or in plain regions. Okay, grasslands. Third region is grassland. A lion lives in a forest or a grassland and is a strong animal that can hunt and kill animals like deer. It is light brown in color. Look at the picture of a lion and that of a deer. See figure 9.8. How are the eyes placed on the face for these two animals? Are they in front or on the side of the face? Lions have long claws in their front leg that can be withdrawn inside the toes. Do the features of a lion help it in any way to survive? Its light brown color help it to hide in dry grasslands when it hunts for prey, animals to be eat. The eyes in front of the face allow it to have a correct idea about the location of its prey. So here we discuss some adaptations or some features of lion which is living in a grassland. First of all we take a look on its color. So its color is light brown, so it can easily hide in the dry grass, okay. So its prey will not be able to see it, okay. Second thing, it has long claws, like nakhun jo bolte hai na Hindi mein, nakhun. It has long claws to hunt the prey, okay. Third thing, we have seen that they are talking about their eyes, position of eyes. So their lion eyes are in front of their face, so can they easily focus on their prey or its hunt. A deer is another animal that lives in a forest and grassland. It has strong teeth for chewing hard plant stems of the forest. A deer needs to know about the presence of predators, okay, animals like lion that make it their prey. In order to run away from them and not become their prey, it has long ears to hear movements of predators. The eyes on the side of its head allow it to look in the all the direction for danger. The speed of the deer help them to run away from the predators. There are many other features of a lion, a deer or other animals and plants that live that help them to survive in their habitat. So we have discussed one more type of animals that living in grassland or in forest, that is deer. And here we see some different features or some different characteristics or some different adaptations of deer compared to the lion. Deer can chew hard stems of any plant, so it has strong teeth. Secondly, to protect, to become prey from predators, okay. Predators means who is going to be hunt, okay, and who is going to be hunt, that is predator and prey. So if he feels that some predator are there, so it help them to hear the sound of that organism or any animal. So it has long ears to listen small kind of sound only, okay. Third thing, they talk about their speed also. So speed help them to save themselves from the predators. Fourth thing, we talk about their eyes. Their eyes is not in the front of their face, okay. Their eyes is in the side of the face, like lion have their eyes in front, but deer have their eyes in sideways, okay. So it help to see in each and every direction, even in behind also, okay, to look in 360 degree direction. Okay, so next is some aquatic habitats. So till now we discussed about terrestrial habitat, in which we have seen desert region, mountain region, grassland. Okay, three different types of regions we discussed in terrestrial region. Now it's a time to some aquatic habitats. Oceans. We already discussed how fish are adapted to live in the sea. Many other sea animals have streamlined bodies to help them move easily in water. There are some sea animals like squids and octopus which do not have this streamlined shape. They stay deeper in the ocean near the seabed and catch any prey that moves towards them. However, when they move in water, they make their body shapes streamlined. These animals have gills to help them use oxygen dissolved in water. So in here also we discuss some more about aquatic animals. Recently in first part we have already seen the talk about the shape of the aquatic animals. The shape of aquatic animals is normally streamlined. Streamlined means broad at the center and narrow at the ends. That is known as streamline. One more time I show you. That is broad at the center. This is broad part. Okay, and this is taper or narrow. So this size is small. This is streamline shape. Streamline shape. Okay. So here one more thing about we discussed, that is about squid. These are one of type of aquatic animals, and octopus. All of you know that what is octopus, which has octo mean eight legs, animals in aquatic life. So aquatic animals, that is octopus, its shape is both the shape of this both organism is not streamlined. Okay, they live generally near the seabed, and which anyone prey comes near along them, they will catch and eat them, like they survive their life. But when they move from one place to another, they make the shape of their body streamlined. Okay, and secondly, they also have gills. Like fish, they also have gills to absorb oxygen dissolved in water, because oxygen, we have already discussed that oxygen is necessary for any living organism. Okay, so there are some sea animals like dolphins and whales that do not have gills. Okay, something new. They breathe in air through nostril or blow holes that are located on the upper parts of their heads. This allow them to breathe in air when they swim near the surface of water. They can stay inside the water for a long time without breathing. They come out to the surface from time to time to breathe in air. Did you ever see this interesting activity of dolphins in television program or film on ocean life? So here we discuss some more about aquatic animals like dolphin and whales. They do not have gills like other fish or octopus or some squids have, but they take oxygen through nostril. Like we have nostril, they also have nostril, or they have some blow holes on their head. So they swim on the upper surface of the water, so they can easily take oxygen or they can easily breathe. Many times you have seen some television program also in which dolphins perform some activities. So this kind of activity we can also see on some Discovery Channel or some YouTube channels also. So next is pond and lakes. Have you seen plants growing in ponds, lakes, rivers and even some drains? Go on a field trip to a nearby pond if possible and try to draw the kind of plants that are seen there. How are these leaves, stems and roots of these plants placed? Some of these plants have their roots fixed in the soil below the water. See figure 9.9. In terrestrial plants, roots normally play a very important role in the absorption of nutrients and water from the soil. However, in aquatic plants, roots are much reduced in size and their main function is to hold the plant in place. So here the totally activities got changed from the terrestrial plants. In terrestrial plants, we have seen that the role of root is to hold the plant and to bring water and minerals to the leaves, to absorb water and minerals from the soil and bring it to the leaves. But in aquatic animals, in aquatic plants, the role is totally get changed. Now it is not to bring water and minerals, because water is already present in aquatic life or ponds or lakes. But the main purpose is root is to withhold the plant at one place. The stem of these plants are long, hollow and light. The stems grow up to the surface of water while the leaves and flower float on the surface of the water. So again the totally changed structure of plant here. The stem is generally hard in terrestrial plant, but in aquatic plants it is hollow, long, and the leaf and flowers are float on the surface of water. Some aquatic plants are totally submerged in water. All parts of such plants grow under water. Some of these plants have narrow and thin ribbon-like leaves. This can bend in the flowing water. In some submerged plant, leaves are often highly divided, through which the water can easily flow without damaging them. So, there are also few plants which are not growing up to the surface of water level, but they grow totally in the water, and their stem is like narrow ribbon-like structure. So, it allows water to pass through them and does not affect its body parts. Okay. So, next is frogs usually have ponds as their habitat. Frogs can stay both inside and pond water as well as move on land. They have strong back legs that help them in leaping and catching their prey. Prey means mosquitoes, flies, so they can eat them and they can survive. They have webbed feet which help them swim in water. So here we discuss some characteristics of or some adaptations of frog which can live in both place, pond, lake as well as on land. It can move to both the places. Second, they told that their hind limbs or legs are very strong to jump and catch the prey. Prey means here we are talking about some flies or mosquitoes or some other insects. Okay, third thing, their structure of their feet, it is like web. Okay, so web, so easily it helps to swim in the water. So this is totally different from us, like our fist is like this, but their feet is covered with some other skin also from here, so it will help in them to swim. So we have discussed only a few common animals and plants compared to the wide variety that live in the different habitats. You may have also noticed that variety in plants around you when you prepared a herbarium as part of the suggested activity in chapter 7. Imagine the kind of variety that you could see in a herbarium of leaves of plants from all the regions of the earth. So here we discussed only few animals or few parts from the animals and plants, but there are huge variety of plants and animals in these regions we can consider, but we are have some limited animals and plants that we have discussed here. So next is 9.4, characteristics of the living beings. So what are the characteristics of living beings? What should they do and what should they do not do? This we will consider in this topic. So we went on a journey through different habitats and discussed many plants and animals in activity 1. We listed objects, plants and animals found in different surroundings. Suppose we stop a while and think which example in our list are living. Let us think of example from a forest. Trees, creepers, small and big, animals, birds, snakes, insects, rocks, soil, water, air, dry leaves, dead animals, mushrooms and moss may be only some of the objects that are present in the forest. Which of these are living? So So here we just see so much different types of things or organism. So we don't know which are living and which are non-living. How we will consider them living or non-living? Think of objects that you can see around you at this moment and group them as living and non-living. In some cases, it is easy for us to know. For example, objects like chair or a table in our home, we know that they are not alive. Pahali was reading this rhyme from Complete Nonsense written by Edward Lear. Okay, so they are saying that see at a moment which thing are around you are living or non-living. Like suppose I am seeing like to this duster. Okay, so I can easily see that it is not living. Okay, similarly I can say about this blackboard. This blackboard is obviously non-living. If I see a sparrow or some other bird, so I can say that it is living. So why we can all of a sudden say that these are living and these are non-living? Still, some I am not saying all, but a few animals or things we can say. We can't say about each and every organism or thing. Okay, so today we will complete here only. In last, that is third part, we will discuss about more about living and non-living things. Thank you. Jai Swaminarayan.